Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here sharing the knowledge, experience, and most important, the types of problems that, that we work on and why we do that. I want to acknowledge the public interest energy research. Some of the slides that I show are the results of funding from the public interest energy research. And the project, the Citrus project that we have, is really very much associated with what I will be showing. I thought that today I'm going to tell you a little bit of who we are, the California Lighting Technology Center, why we do what we do, and how we do it, and what the Citrus project is and what we expect from it. So the California Lighting Technology Center was put together sometime after 2000, and around 2003, the Department of Energy, the US Department of Energy, had put seed funding for Michael Seminovich, actually, from Lawrence Berkeley Lab. Michael and I spent about 21 years at Lawrence Berkeley Lab before we moved to Davis. So while we were still at the Berkeley Lab, with Department of Energy funding, we work with the National Electrical Manufacturers Association. And at that time, the ultimate objective was to bridge what was called the Valley of Death, the laboratory to the marketplace. And Michael spent a lot of time talking with NEMA, the National Electrical Manufacturers Association, specifically the Luminaire group, the Lamps group, and the Controls group, trying to understand their needs and desires, and also match them with the needs and desires in California. The public interest research got involved. NEMA came up with a business plan for the California Lighting Technology Center. Pierre liked what they saw. They said, find a home, we will support it along with NEMA. UC Davis ended up being our home at the right time, at the right place. So that's how the CLTC was being founded. Our mission is very, very clear, very focused. It allows us to make decisions on what to do pretty fast. And the key words there, as you see, is commercialization and energy efficient technologies for both lighting and daylighting. The way that we try to work along this mission is with three types of activities. We started with R&D, 21 years at Lawrence Berkeley Lab. We were pretty good at it. And pretty soon we realized that we really need to take the technologies out of the lab and demonstrate them out in the field so that people know what we do. And most important, try to get some feedback and test them in a real environment. 21 years of research, we knew that in the lab we could make anything work and that usually things break when they go into the out world. So we created a whole field testing and demonstration program in collaboration with the California Institute for Energy and, Energy and Environment. And truly that is, I believe, the center of the valley where you take technology from the lab, from one side, and then you really put it out there in the market to see how well it's going to perform and what it is that people will think about it. When we started doing the demonstration, we realized that electricians were far from ready to work with the advanced technologies that we were putting out there, like advanced digital controls. When you flip a switch on the wall, people don't really know what's happening. Are you collecting two wires, or are you sending a message to an addressable luminaire telling it what to do? So we started with California Utilities along a research outreach and education and training program for professionals, electricians and contractors. And today we're also educating designers. And it's interesting that these types of activities, they need to happen together in a harmonious way to see accelerated commercialization of new technologies. The other key element in meeting the mission is that it's impossible to do anything alone. In fact, there are many, many people that need to play significant roles to make this happen. And we are partnering with utilities, manufacturers, end users, builders, designers, researchers, academicians, governmental agencies. Anybody that wants to comment and look at what we do and help is always welcome. In 2004, we opened the doors at the California Lighting Technology Center. And today, we have succeeded in having a very, very large number of partners. You can see the founding organization at the top. We have a lot of different utilities. The California Utilities, the three investor-owned utilities, and SMUD were with us from the very first day, and we have added some more. We have a very large number of manufacturers, even larger than this. These are the current affiliate members that we work today, and also large end users. The strategy there is when we had an idea, bring the manufacturers who will make the technology and the people, the end users who will use it, and bring them on the table day one. Let's agree on a spec, and if we meet it, the the manufacturer commits to making it, and the end user commits to trying it out. So that's how we have moved forward. Another thing that changed, of course, is we grew up. We have now a pretty large team. You can see all of us here dressed in black to honor Michael Seminovic, the director, who had just gotten the Arthur Rosenfeld Chair in Energy Efficiency. There was actually a chair there. You can see him sitting in there. So these are the people who make it happen, and quite a lot of what I will discuss, these people play the major role in seeing it through. The specific project in Citrus that we have is a collaborative effort between UC Berkeley with Professor David Auslander and myself, SPIs from UC Davis. And it is focused on advanced lighting control algorithms. And what I will do today is I will try to explain why we need them and what they look like and how we hope to make it through. The overall vision is not just about ultra smart luminaires, which was the first title that I had on the title slide. The vision includes also smart windows and the smart skylights. And when I say smart, I'm talking about entities like luminaires windows that they carry sensors with them, and they have their own brain, and they can sense their environment to figure out what to do. And the ultra smart, the ultra comes for the fact that they can also communicate, and they can learn from their neighbors, be that windows or skylights or other luminaires, about the space to make a better job in sensing. The specific project in Citrus is much, much more focused. By the way, the overall vision includes also multiple strategies like daylight harvesting, occupancy vacancy controls, HVAC optimization. While this specific project is smaller in scope and it is at the very guts of what we hope to achieve, the actual algorithms that will tell the devices what is happening and what they should be doing. So this project is focused only on ultra-smart luminaires and only on daylight harvesting, which, as you will see, it's pretty challenging. The driving forces behind the work that we do is really California legislation. California has always been at the forefront, and we're very happy to be here. And you can see here the Global Warming Act, Solutions Act, AB 32, that was signed in 2006. Brought up the issue of saving electricity not only on peak demand, that was a priority up at that time, but at any time during the day or the night, again trying to bring the greenhouse gas emissions down. The next year, in 2007, we had the Huffman Bill, AB 1109. That was focused entirely on lighting. And the whole idea was to reduce the lighting energy consumption in residential lighting by 50% based on 2007 levels. Those was the year that the bill was signed. And for commercial and outdoor lighting by 25% reduction. And a few years later, 3 years later, the California Public Utilities Commission put together the California Strategic Lighting Plan, again focusing on lighting. And the whole idea was to reduce the statewide electricity for lighting by 60 to 80% by 2020. It's a pretty, pretty aggressive goal. And the only way to meet it is to go way beyond standard practice meaning the codes, and go towards what we call best practice. Usually, the codes, the energy codes, truly represent a floor of performance. And to be frank, by definition, a building which just meets the energy codes, it is the worst building that we can legally build. So there is plenty of work that can happen above it. And this was the assumption and the drive of the California Public Utilities Commission strategic plan, that we will move into these best practices. And the plan included more than half a dozen of specific types of measures. Daylight harvesting has been a major strategy for energy efficiency for a long time. And the idea is to reduce electric lighting in commercial buildings where people work, especially next to windows and under skylights, reduce the electric lighting to save electric light energy, and also the heat that is associated with the production of light. And the savings are significantly very, very promising. And also the other thing is that daylight coincides with the peak electricity demand. So reducing electric lighting during those peak hours when we have the most daylight, it's also an excellent way to reduce peak demand. You can see the load that we are trying to address. This is the distribution of the loads in commercial buildings. And you can see that lights are about 30%. So we can take a big bite out of this and also a smaller bite out of the cooling that is associated with lighting. In fact, day lighting has been a strategy that, at least on paper, seems to be extremely effective. The savings are very, very promising, that it has made the California Title 24, which is the code, for quite some time now. This is the current code in 2008, and you can see that if you have a space under one ceiling that's more than 8,000 square feet, and the ceiling is greater than 15 feet, you have to put skylights, and you have to put electric lighting controls. And the proposed code that will take into effect in 2014 has reduced the 15 feet down to 11. So it's going to take more big box retail and warehouses and so on and so forth. And on side lighting, meaning in areas next to windows, you need to have electric lighting controls to control the electric lights and dim them down based on available daylight. And the cons become pretty specific. We have done into areas where for skylights, you can very clearly define what the daylit area. And in these daylit areas, any luminaire that illuminates those areas has to comply with electric lighting controls. Here you see how the computation of the area under skylights is. And here you can see how the computation of the areas next to windows, which is usually one head height deep into the space as the primary area. You get plenty of daylight close to the windows. And then on the back, a second head height, which is a secondary area. And again, you can get significantly enough to at least dim the lights to at least 50%. How do we do that? The best way to do that is with photosensors. We have tried to use timers like astronomy calendar that knows the sunrises and the sunsets, which works as long as we only always have the same type of a day. If you have a cloudy day, the clock doesn't really know that it's cloudy, and it is going to start dimming the lights down when you need them. So the best approach is to really use a photosensor. Here is the example of the whole system. A photosensor is looking into the space. It feeds its signal to a logic controller, and the logic controller, based on the signal of the photosensor, tells the power controllers where to adjust the electric lights. There are two main sensing strategies that we use for photosensors. One is what is called the closed loop. You can see it here on the left, where we have a photosensor like in the previous slide, where it looks and reads the light reflected from the area where the electric lights are being controlled. And it's called closed loop because when we adjust the lights, the change of the light levels affect the photosensor whose signals is used to control them. And then we have on the right here the open loop, where we put the photosensor out of the space that is being controlled or looking through a skylight or through a window, and it is not affected by the electric light that it controls. Now, how well are we doing with these approaches? I'll give you the Walmart story. Walmart came to us in 2006, and they said that we have been trying to do daylight harvesting in our big box retail for about 11 years. We started in 1995. And we don't seem to be getting it right. We either overdim and people complain, or we underdim and we don't get the savings that we expect. So I asked them what it is that they did. And they said in the beginning, we used what's called a closed loop, because in the literature we saw that that's the best way to put a sensor that looks into the space that you try to control and based on the lights, deal with the electric lights. And they said we did it. There was an electric engineering guru from Chicago that installed the sensor and tuned up the system, commissioned it to make it work and start the dimming at the right time and finish the dimming at the right time with the right levels of daylight. And everything was working. We tried it for a couple of days. We had some pain, and then the electrician left, and everybody was happy. And we started deploying in the rest of our, when they came to us, they had about 7,000 stores. They now may be at 8,000 or 9,000. And they said that everything was fine until a few weeks later they got a call from that store and they said, help, all of the lights are off and people are complaining, we don't know what to do. So they flew immediately the guru from Chicago, who came in and immediately saw the problem. They had a sale, they released balloons. One of the balloons went close to the photosensor saw a lot of reflected light and the lights off. I would like to take this opportunity to say that in all of these years that I have been doing this type of R&D, technology has never failed me. Technology will always do what I tell it to do. Where I usually fail, or we as a team, is not being able to fully understand under what conditions the technology will find itself and what it is that people will do that. And this example from the Walmart is a great one. They also started getting complaints from other stores that they had put the system. They sold the brown tents and they put white linen, and then the guru had to come back from Chicago. And having so many stores, they realized that that's not the way that we can operate here. We spend more money on paying the people to commission and recommission the system. So they went into the open loop approach, having a photosensor turned the other way and looking up through the skylight. And this is what they had when they came to us. They said within a few months, we got rid of the closed loop. We went into the open loop, which works well during cloudy days and clear days, but it doesn't do such a good job early in the day and late in the day when the dimming happens, because it seems to be happening too fast no matter what we do. And also in partly cloudy days, the light starts turning on and turning off, and we have to override it. And just if the lights come on after they are off in the beginning of the day, we let them on for an hour, and we lose significant savings. So we concluded from that, from what we heard, that truly reliability of operation was the number one problem. And then the cost was again a problem, not so much the cost of the components, not even so much the cost of the commissioning to have an initial calibration of the system. The main costs were the person that had to come again and again, and of course for them the biggest cost was the lost productivity employees and the lost productivity in terms of making money from the clients that were not happy and they were trying to figure out what happened with the lights. Also, in terms of skylights, the energy cost becomes an issue. In my mind, as an architect, the main priority and the main function of a window is not to bring daylight to turn the electric lights off. It's to connect us with the outside, the view. That's the biggest function of a window. And oh, by the way, there is also daylight coming in. Why don't we use it to save some electric lighting? On the contrary, with skylights, the skylight is put up there mainly to put light in. So if the electric lighting controls do not work, we are not missing opportunities like with windows. We are really paying a lot of penalties, because those holes could be, if they were a ceiling and we were not losing heat or gaining solar heat gain, we would have a better solution. So looking at the situation and what they tried, they had many other stories to tell us about technologies failed. We came up with the idea of combining two sensors, an open loop and a closed loop, and then having the algorithm consult with both. At the same time, we succeeded in automatically recalibrating the closed loop based on the changes that were happening into the space. And I'll show you how we do that. But the operation to complete that, again, is based on the closed loop. The open loop, that's what I forgot to say. Sorry. The open loop didn't work that well for the dimming early in the day and late in the day, mainly because the sensor looking up, as soon as the sun would come out, it would see quite a lot of light. And that light was increasing extremely fast. And they couldn't truly deal with such a large signal growing so fast to have a control algorithm that will work with light levels into the space. So the idea is we use again the closed loop as the main sensor, but when the closed loop senses more light or less light, before the controller decides what to do with the lights, it consults the open loop. And if there is agreement on the rate of change, then we are more sure that true, we have a true change in daylight, and it's not because the merchandise has changed or even people are carrying different color objects under the sensor. How do we do the automatic continuously calibration? We developed an algorithm which is really based on the signal on the photosensor only from electric lights. No matter if there is daylight coming in the room or not, if I turn the electric lights on or off, or if I take them through their dimming range, I can record that signal of the photosensor that's only from electric lights. And we use that line, if you like, that relationship as the main part of the algorithm. Now, we can measure it, we measure it actually automatically as soon as the system is installed to do an initial calibration, it happens automatically. From then on, we also verify this calibration every time that we adjust the lights, either upwards or downwards. Remember that we had an initial calibration. The idea here is that every time that we change the light levels from one level to another, we have a very specific expectation on how the signal will change. And if the space had not changed, that number would always be the same. If the space has changed, the number would be different. So if it is different, we conclude that the space has changed. And since that change is in the basis of the algorithm, we just use the new value. It works pretty nicely. And it works pretty nicely for long-term changes, like I change the merchandise or I change the table cover, all the way to small-term changes, short-term changes, like people passing under the sensor. The sensor will calibrate as soon as I pass with a white shirt, and it's going to recalibrate again as soon as I'm done. And it works pretty nicely. We installed the new system. You can see here we actually moved the laboratory prototype into the West Sacramento Walmart store. And it was 2008 at that time. They gave us three lines of lights. They were expecting to make some money that Christmas period. It was the economy was going really down. And we had an opportunity to collect the dual loop installed on this skylight here to the open loop, which was installed on this skylight there. Excuse me. And the sensors were both sending their signal in a computer back in a storage area, and the computer was running the algorithm. Here is a picture of the area under the sensor, and you can see that in December they were selling Christmas stuff. In January they changed and they put white plastic containers, and then in February they went back into all kinds of other types of things. At the same time, we had a sensor up where we, a camera where we had the sensor. And you can see here, of course, the sensor had a wider view, but you can see here what the camera would see right under the sensor. You can see on the 25th of December the signal of the sensor only from electric lighting was 4.75 units. And you can see here on January 5, when we got the white containers, it went up to almost 7. That's an increase of almost 50%. So again, we verified why the closed loop was not working on its own. With the closed loop, however, the sensor was automatically compensating for the difference and the changes in, along with the open loop signal, and the system worked beautifully. It had a very smooth dimming. It was starting to dim half an hour earlier than the open loop and ended up half an hour later. It was taking it about 1.5 hours to go from fully for full output to zero output, while the open loop was taking about half an hour. The results, you can see here on the open loop and the dual loop, these are a little bit complicated graphs. I'll explain them. Here on the y-axis, you have the frequency of occurrence of light levels above or below the target. The target is here at the zero. This range here is the minus 10 plus 10% of the target light level that we wanted to have. And you see here the open loop, most of the time they are under dimming. They provide more light when they should. And that was a conscious decision so that the people don't complain. That was their priority. You can also see this long bar over here going up to 20% of the time. Those are the times that up in Davis they had the partly cloudy days. And Davis is a place where we have very few partly cloudy days. You can imagine what would happen in other locations. That bar would be much, much larger. The dual loop was able to concentrate most of the output of the electric lighting very, very close to zero towards 10%. Their system many times would override us. If the lights would turn on with the dual loop, then the same algorithm that they were using for the open loop would keep the lights off for an hour. The results that we got in terms of energy, these are per ballast. The gray bar, you can see down here the months, December, January, all the way to November 09. Remember that this is a 24/7 operation. They don't close at night. So there is a base lighting during the night that there is no way to eliminate through daylighting. The gray bar is no lighting controls at all. The blue bar is the open loop. And you see that it is doing a pretty good job. It saves them about a quarter of the energy, which is significant considering the 24/7 operation. And then you see the dual loop that gave them even more energy savings, 50% more energy savings than what they were getting. But the thing that they really appreciated more than anything is that people never complain in the area where the dual loop was operating because the dimming was pretty smooth. We played a little bit with economics, so upgrading from an open loop to a dual loop, like you already have your dimming ballast, even with ridiculously expensive prices, $1,000 for the dual sensor and another $1,000 to install it, came out to about a couple of months. So it's really a no-brainer, and Walmart was all over it. And even if you were starting with no daylighting controls at all to go to the dual loop, where you would need to also buy the dimming ballasts, again, with pretty blown out costs for technology, we had under 3 years payback, which makes now this approach for skylights very, very attractive. And we're working with Vatstoppel Legrand, a company down in South Bay. You can see here a commercial prototype. This is the Minolta meters of the laboratory prototype, and you can see next to it a commercial prototype. Right now, it's in final beta testing, and I hope to be able to put it in the West Sacramento Walmart before Christmas. Now I'm starting to get into the citrus project. When we solved the skylight problem, we were extremely happy, mainly because we had a very reliable way for people to meet the code. And we also tried it for side lighting. Side lighting, it's much, much more difficult. To start with, we have shading devices, Venetian blinds that people close and open. Or the ultra-smart windows will open them and close them based on their logic and sensing. Also, people can go in between a sensor. You can see here, I call the reference sensor. It's a sensor looking towards the window. You can see it here. So pretty much we try to do exactly what we did for skylights, aiming an open loop sensor towards the window. This would work, and we made the algorithms to work. However, as you can see, it requires commissioning. Somebody has to go there and really manipulate the field of view of the photosensor that is looking at the window and place it so that it does so. And when we realized that we're going to need commissioning, we thought that we're going to have many, many failures out there in the field if you expect people for every installation to do it right. That's when we had the idea of working with luminaires, each of which has its own closed-loop sensor. The idea was that if I had multiple sensors in a room, all of them closed-loop looking at the space, I can fool one sensor at a time, like I'm passing under it with a white shirt or a black shirt. But fooling all of the sensors in the same way and at the same time would really need a choreography. Interestingly enough, it was about a month ago, someone described me this choreography, which I guess can happen. There was this school someplace in California. They had installed over the summer a very nice daylighting control system with a sensor up on the ceiling, etc. And the joke that I make, I'll make it today too, is that electric lighting controls with photosensors can really work. If you put the sensor, you bring the commissioning agent and they commission it, they work as long as you lock the door and you don't let anybody in. Well, in the school, they had to let the kids in the classroom. So in the first day of classes, the system didn't work. They called the electrician. He went there. He looked it up in the afternoon. He said, it's working. Next day, again, as soon as the class started, the lights were all off and people were complaining. Third day, the electrician said, I'm going to be there when the students come in. So he was there, and the students came in, noise, etc. And then the teacher came in, and they said, OK, everybody quiet. Please open your books at page 15. So that's the choreography there. All of the students open up their books, and the lights turned off. So again, you can really break any system if you really want so. But we think that those are going to be the exceptions. So here you can see a concept where I have a room with a fenestration in here from where the daylight comes in. I have individual luminaires. Each luminaire illuminates its own area and senses its own area. And the whole idea is that if each luminaire was getting the signals of the others as reference, we would be able to have a more reliable sensing. And with the sensors and actuators inside every luminaire, we don't need commissioning. We can just install the luminaires and they will know what to do. If we see the bigger picture on controls, traditionally the main school was that we're going to have a computer someplace in a building. It's going to be a single brain. And that brain will collect signals from all of the sensors, and it is going to be sending signals to all actuators telling them what to do, which can happen. But if you start having hundreds or thousands of sensors and actuators, you start having some significant timing problems. And you can see here, I try to put a table where I said, what if we start moving that single brain from one brain for the billing to have one brain per floor, or maybe one brain per space, or maybe one brain per area in a space, like 1 to 3 areas here, or even a brain per luminaire, which is what we want to do with the ultra smart luminaires. And you can see here some indications. I didn't do any math here. But if you need installation of sensors independent of luminaires and commissioning of those sensors and the luminaires being individual components to make them work as a system, you are asking for quite a lot of money, both on installation and commissioning. With luminaires, we expect that the installation will be almost nothing. If you install the luminaire, the sensors go with it. And the commissioning, we know how to do automatic commissioning and calibration, so we wouldn't truly need anything. And on the operation, again, there isn't truly much that you can do. The system operates on its own. Here is the concept of the ultra-smart luminaire. You can see a graphic here where we put an occupancy sensor, a couple of light sensors. If I have only one luminaire, again, with two luminaires on two ends that look at different areas, I could apply the same logic. And possibly an outdoor sensor that also sends messages on what's happening outside. And you can see here the integrated sensors, logic controllers, and actuators, which, if they are in their raw form, when we buy a photosensor, an occupancy sensor, most of the money for it is for the plastic that covers it. If we get the guts, and we don't need expensive guts, we are not measuring illuminance there, we don't care about absolute values. We care about accuracy within the range that we want to measure in terms of relative accuracy. Twice the light should give twice the signal. And the customization can happen in the factory. I can have the sensor with a field of view and a directional sensitivity to really match the area that the luminaire is supposed to illuminate. And the CITRIS project is really focusing on the heart of our hopes on developing algorithms that will allow these smart objects to talk to each other and best understand if the changes that they see is true daylight change or because of people moving in the space or other luminaires moving up and down. Now, also you can get through communications messages, either sending them to anyone interested, like other luminaires, or receiving them from other folks of interest, like in addition to luminaires, windows and HVAC system on their status, am I heating, am I cooling, to also utilities where they send demand response signals for emergency when we go for a brownout or a blackout, or also from weather stations in terms of predicting what the cloudiness will be and what the light levels will be. At CLTC, we are in the process of building a new daylight harvesting laboratory. You can see it here with two main areas. One area is the area that I showed before that will have four luminaires that we're going to be playing with. And this area in the front is going to become a daylight simulator. In the past, we had windows on that area which we closed now. They were exterior windows because you had a true sunrise and a true sunset only once a day. Here with a daylight simulator, we can have 60 sunrises in a day to truly focus on testing the algorithms much, much more effectively and efficiently. You can see here a fenestration elevation. We are in front of the daylight simulator looking into the space. And you can see here the section with the office space and the daylight simulator. Here you see some of the CAD drawings when we were dreaming about it. And here it is actually being built. You can see the openings where we're starting to install the four luminaires to start operating on it. Here is the area of the daylight simulator, and we have all of this wall up here is going to be full of lamps. And here are some drawings of the fluorescent lighting that we're going to have. They're going to come in frames of 4x4 that you can pull out, rotate, so that you can even change the orientation of the lamps. The lamps will all be individually dimmable by a computer, so we can have different distributions of sky brightness, either vertically or horizontally or in any way that we want to achieve it. We are also developing a special instrument that we will mount onto the window, no matter how large they are. We can very easily construct one of those in a day, and then put photosensors along this arc that will measure the directionality of the light coming into the space, how much comes from the sky, how much comes from the ground, and so on and so forth. In fact, we expect that we may be able to use the signals of these photosensors to drive and set the output of the lamps depending on what kind of specific distributions we want from the daylight simulator. In the meantime, we started playing with the SMAP database, which is one of the main products of the CITRIS program. It stores time series, And our hope is that in the beginning, by just storing the signals of the different luminaires, we're going to be able to see the relationships between each other. And by dimming each one, we're going to see the effects of the other luminaires. And that type of information will be part of the logic of each individual luminaire. So we have a few sensors in there, and we have connected them to a SMAP going from the light source, be that daylight or electric light, through LIGOR photosensors that convert the radiation to milliamps that go into amplifiers, converted into volts, going into a National Instruments data acquisition system, turn them into illuminance light units, and storing them in the database. Here you can see on the next slide, actually, the signal of one of those sensors from yesterday. It took us some time to keep it going up in the morning. You see, we have missed some elements. You should know that this project is only a few weeks old. I think it's a little bit than 3 or 4 weeks old. And we are very happy that we have already succeeded in populating SMAP with the data streams that we will be generating. I'm going to close by getting a little bit closer to the overall vision, which is, again, the daylight harvesting strategy that I described before. But I cheated a little bit. I didn't say the whole story. The whole story, if you want to do it right and get the best out of daylighting, truly goes into what I call the daylight optimization, where you bring enough daylight to minimize the electric lighting requirements, and then after the lights are off, you manage the daylight at the window level or the skylight level so that you don't bring any more daylight to manage and minimize glare and HVAC loads. We have started, again, with Public Interest Energy Research Fund, a program on smart windows and skylights, where the windows, they carry their own sensors, both inside and outside, occupancy sensor, light sensors, temperature sensors. We can inform the HVAC. It's about time that the HVAC industry comes up to speed, and they have good conditions, thermal conditions everywhere, not only where the thermostat is. And we believe that we can send them quite a lot of information to help them in that effort. You can see some of the prototypes that we have. This is an electrochromic glazing that on demand by electricity we can change in transmittance from 3% to 63%. You can see here from the side a vertical pull-down shade. And the idea here is, again, we are smart enough when everybody leaves the room to have an occupancy sensor detect vacancy and turn the electric lights off. We can do more with windows. Like, I could bring in a solar heat gain reflector when nobody's in the room, when it is the cooling season, so that I don't bring any more solar heat gain, even if I have to completely darken the room. Or if it is the heating season, I can lift the shading device and let the sun blast the space and help with the heating load. The whole idea, and we're also working with the Western Cooling Efficiency Center at UC Davis with Mark Modera, on an integrated approach it has an integrated control strategy that it's pretty simple, and that's why we hope that it's going to work. During occupancy, we focus on comfort, and during vacancy, we focus on energy efficiency. So during occupancy, we adjust the fenestration for daylight penetration, reduction of glare. Then we adjust the electric lighting based on the available daylight in the space, and then we adjust the HVAC for thermal comfort and indoor air quality. And during vacancy, we adjust fenestration not for comfort now and daylight penetration, but for cooling and heating loads. And we turn the electric lights off or we dim them down, and then we adjust the HVAC for thermal comfort and indoor air quality. And with this, I'm going to close. Thank you very much, and I'll be happy to try and answer questions if you have.
Thank you. Thank you, Kostas. We'll open the floor for questions. Okay, well, I have a question.
Absolutely.
So in the case of the Walmart where you have a combined sensors up in the ceiling, would it be possible to, instead of having the combined sensors in the ceiling, but have a single sensor that is measuring the incident lighting at task level at the floor level?
Yes, that's a great question. And truly, we could have that. The main issue is, where do you put that sensor? You put it at the top of the rack, you put it on the, because people said that too, why don't we put it where we want it? There are two main issues with that. One is truly how much light will arrive at the surface, but and then more or less all of the store will have to live with what was happening there. The light that arrives at the sensor, it has a direct component. It also has a reflected component. So if you start playing with the surfaces that are near that sensor, you're going to affect it. The other thing that it is even more important for me is that illuminance, it's not really a good metric for comfort. The only reason that we use illuminance is because it's very inexpensive and fast to measure. Truly, what the eye sees is luminance distributions coming into it from all directions. So we don't believe that that is a pretty good metric. We would rather use the contribution of the electric lighting itself on the environment and what that is. And the assumption is that if you are happy with what the electric lighting is giving into the space, you should be happy with what we give, especially with skylights, because the daylight comes from the same direction as the electric lights. On the windows, it's a bit trickier because the electric light comes from the top and the daylight from the side. We'll see what we will find, but it's a good question.
Okay. We have more questions.
Costas, could you go back to the slides about the ultra smart strategy? I'm not sure I really followed what you're proposing there. So.
This one.
Yeah, and then yes. And maybe explain a little bit more what's going on.
Okay.
I'm maybe a little slow, but
no problem. The ultra smart luminaire, it's smart because it has its own sensors, so it can sense the environment on its own. It doesn't expect some outside sensor to be connected to its power supply through commissioning. It is an integral part of it. When it comes from the factory, the sensor or sensors, in this particular case, I saw two sensors. They are both photosensors, one on each end of the luminaire. So I sense and I'm calibrated at the factory to sense a different area than the other photosensor. Let's say that I'm now passing under the sensor. The sensor, the first sensor, when it sees the color of my shirt, if it is white, it's going to think that there is more light. But the other sensor here, not being affected at the same time, it's going to say, I don't think so. So if both sensors agree that there is a daylight change, the probability of them being correct is much higher. And I don't need to look at this smart with sensors outside of the luminaire. The luminaire can do it as it came from the factory. I don't need to do anything to it. So that's why it's smart. Now, it is ultra smart because not only it gets the signals from its own sensors, it also takes signals from the other smart luminaires around it, and it can figure out which they are automatically, for instance, by one of the smart luminaires saying, I'm dimming myself from 0 to 100. And everybody else stops, and they record the signal that they got in their sensors from that luminaire moving up and down. That relationship, if those luminaires will not be moved physically, should remain the same. And the two luminaires that are closer to the window, we are going to be at higher levels than the two luminaires that are back. The front and the back, and the other front and the back, should have pretty much the same type of relationships. So these are the things that we are looking into, trying to understand if changes in the signals of the sensors are because of people moving in the space and objects being changed, or if they are true from daylight. And especially when we link them with the ultra-smart windows that can tell them how much light is outside, and they can also tell them, I'm now deploying my shading device, they would expect exactly what change to see. So that's the whole idea there. What we want to do with the Citrus project is focus on this time series that we're going to be collecting and what is the smart way of utilizing this data to make sure that we instruct each luminaire on how to behave based on all of these signals that come from different directions. Is it clearer now?
Yes, sir.
Thanks.
There are not any questions, I have a follow-up question.
OK, there's a follow-up question.
So I'm wondering if the sensors could be cameras and what you might conclude if you had more data about the actual distribution of light.
Yeah. This is a great question, too. Cameras can do a great job because, in fact, it's the equivalent of multiple sensors for every luminaire. It's really an excellent way of moving forward. There are two main issues. One is a social type of an issue. People don't want to be monitored. So if I have it in an office space, I don't believe that they would feel comfortable. And we have seen that even in offices where we tried to install occupancy sensors and people said no because they didn't trust us that we didn't have a video camera in it. Now video cameras can be little holes. You see them on the different magazines, the spy cameras, etc. That's one, the privacy issue. The second one, which is even more important, if I have a video camera, there is no way to do it without calibration. I would have to go in and explain to the system which parts of the image that they see are parts that make sense and parts that don't. Lighting Science, a group that makes electric lighting, they have come up with a system like that. It's the first commercial that I have seen. I know at least half a dozen of laboratory types of systems which can even tell you if people are smiling or not. The algorithms are very, very long and difficult to make them small, that they can run on small CPUs, and they need somebody to tell them what to do. The Lighting Science people had a very nice and very interesting way of specifying where to look for occupancy movement. They don't use it for light, they use it for occupancy, which again can do a great job, and actually you can use them for both. But you have to go in the image and draw a line and say, if this line gets violated with something passing, that means occupancy for me. So if you had an outdoor sensor and you have a tree that would be moving from the wind, that area is excluded because you didn't draw a line through that. But you're going to need to commission every single camera. And when I hear about commissioning, that's labor that's going to make it much, much higher. Yeah, so that's, it can work, and I think that it's, it may be the future. But with today's reality, I'm not sure that it's ready for the market.
Hi. I want to know what is the time that the energy savings takes to pay off for the equipment installation, for example, in the Walmart warehouse and in a smaller setup like a living room?
I'm going to go back to this slide, and this is why the Walmart is so excited about it. We did hear the math. You see they have about 1,000 ballasts per store. And if you do the math, they are going to be saving per year about 8 cents for every square foot. They have about 150,000 square feet per store. They have about, I don't know, 7,000 to 9,000 stores. Do the math. It's about, I think, approaching 30 million per year. So this particular case is with Walmart. It pays very fast, and it's going to give them a tremendous amount of money considering the magnitude of the square feet that we are going to be saving energy from. Yeah. In other cases where you're going to need to spend more money to buy dimming ballasts, or the Walmart already has them, again, it goes up to giving them 22 cents per square foot. It's going to take about 3 years to pay it back. Having said that, I would like to say something else about the payback. I get somehow disappointed when I hear the question, what's the payback? And I hear it every time when I try to tell to somebody, use an energy efficient measure. And the reason is that when I hear that question, what is the payback period, what I really hear is, you know, I don't care that much about energy efficiency. It doesn't really have inherent value for me. But if I make money, and if I make it money fast, then I might consider it. And I think this recognition of lack of inherent value in energy efficiency, it's the wrong message and the wrong foot forward. It would be nice if we acknowledge the value of energy efficiency in ways that we acknowledge the value of a 200 stereo for our car or a granite top for our kitchen. And unfortunately, I don't see us doing that. At least I urge people to go to life cycle cost. So over the life of the technology, if they have a positive outcome, they should be happy. And in many cases, with people who own their buildings, I have succeeded in that. But I would like to see more than that. I would like to see us as a society willing to pay. Of course, this happening, individuals cannot see benefit at the individual level, but collectively the state does. And all of the utility programs on rebates and incentives are specifically for this purpose. So even if the technologies are a little bit more expensive and they cannot meet payback periods criteria that businesses have, that's where the state comes in and the utilities, and they try to bring the cost of the technology down to make it happen. Long answer, but it's a great one, a great question, because that's the heart of things happening or not.
Yeah, because if they don't say anything,
I'm sorry?
Like if they don't have any money savings, they won't take the system.
Well, they will not take the system if they have money, but they are not going to make money because they install the system. And you cannot blame the corporations for doing that. Many of the businesses are there, and their mission is to make money for their shareholders. I think it's the mission of the government to help for the global good, and I'm very happy to see California and many other states truly having very, very strong programs trying to ease the market penetration of new technologies into the society and expect that with increased production, the costs will go down, which is happening. It's happening with LEDs, with digital controls and communications. So I think that we are on the right track after all.
So for the small setup, it will be even larger?
I'm sorry? Well, it's the same thing that many technologies don't really make sense at very, very small installations. Like, take an example, the compact fluorescent lamp. If you come to me and you say, get this compact fluorescent lamp, you put it in your house, you're going to save $5 at the end of the year, $5 will not make me click. Now, if I had 1,000 CFLs in my house, 5,000 would make me click. So now you can see why, with 2 cents per square foot, the Walmart is so happy. If they had a small mom-and-pop store, it might have not made such a big difference. So it's truly a matter of scales that makes things change.
Okay, I think that's it. Thank you very much again. Thanks again, Kostas.
All right. There is one, yeah, thank you. There is one more question, but we can resolve it later.